It's Nigeria. Acara Bienal Forum ini terdiri dari 3 hari, dan hari ini kita bekerja sama dengan Simposium Katulistiwa akan memperbincangkan tentang lokal, kosmopolitan, dan relasional. Untuk tamu hari ini, untuk pembicara hari ini adalah Nicholas Borio. Akan membicarakan tentang 20 tahun perjalanan dari Maaf 20 tahun perjalanan relational aesthetic menuju altar modern. Good morning, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you for coming. We want to say welcome to this Biennale Forum as a part of Jogja Biennale, the 13th Jogja Biennale Hacking Conflicts Indonesia meets Nigeria. And this forum will be held in 3 days to have a conversation of local, cosmopolitan, and relational. And this day we have Nicola Borio, and we will talk about 20 years journeys from relational aesthetic towards altar modern. Tidak berlama-lama lagi, saya langsung akan memasuki acara yang pertama, yaitu sambutan dari Alia Swastika sebagai Direktur Jogja Biennale yang ke-13. Please come to Alia Swastika as a Director of the 13th Jogja Biennale to have a space.
Good morning, welcome everyone. Selamat pagi semuanya. Terima kasih sekali atas kehadiran teman-teman dalam acara Biennale Forum dalam rangka Biennale Jogja ke-13 Hacking Conflict Indonesia meets Nigeria. We would like to welcome and gratitude for your attendance to Jogja Biennale Forum. It's part of the 13th Biennale Jogja Indonesia meets Nigeria. The exhibition itself is happening now in Jogja National Museum. Biennale Forum adalah sebuah acara yang ditradisikan semenjak Biennale Jogja ke-12 tahun 2013 yang lalu. Terlalu silau ya. Jadi selain menyelenggarakan acara pameran, dalam Biennale Jogja sendiri diselenggarakan banyak sekali kegiatan yang lain. Kami juga menyelenggarakan apa yang disebut sebagai Festival Ekuator, yaitu acara yang berupaya untuk mengakomodasi dan memfasilitasi praktik-praktik seni yang lain yang ada di Yogyakarta, terutama di sekitaran wilayah-wilayah pinggiran seperti Kulon Progo, Gunung Kidul, Bantul, dan di wilayah kota Jogja sendiri. Kami juga menyelenggarakan apa yang disebut sebagai parallel events, yaitu program open call yang bersifat interdisipliner dan mendukung pada proses-proses pembentukan seni sebagai bagian dari aktivitas kolektif. Dan juga salah satu acara lain adalah Biennale Forum ini, di mana kami berupaya untuk menjadi satu platform bagi perbincangan-perbincangan dan mendorong adanya pemikiran-pemikiran intelektual baru sebagai bagian dari praktek penciptaan karya seni. Kami juga melihat bahwa menjadi penting dalam praktek kesenian hari-hari ini untuk melihat seni tidak saja dalam kerangka estetika atau praktik artistiknya, tetapi juga melihat bagaimana seni ditempatkan dalam diskursus-diskursus ilmu sosial dan kebudayaan yang lebih luas. Tema tentang tahun ini, tema Biennale Forum tahun ini tentang yang lokal, kosmopolitan, dan relasional, terutama juga berangkat dari pendekatan kuratorial dari Biennale Jogja ke-13 tahun ini yang dikuratori oleh Wok The Rock dan Jim Anokwi, di mana mereka menciptakan banyak sekali pendekatan-pendekatan yang sifatnya interaktif, partisipatori, dan social engaged art. Jadi kami ingin melihat kembali bagaimana nilai dan posisi seni-seni semacam ini dalam konteks seni rupa di Indonesia secara umum, dan terutama situasi pergerakan masyarakat Indonesia kontemporer akhir-akhir ini. Saya kira itu saja pengantar dari saya. Mungkin sedikit mensummary dalam bahasa Inggris mungkin ya. So the Biennale Forum is actually a platform that provides the opportunity and the possibility for conversations on different disciplines in the art scene in Indonesia and particularly in Yogyakarta. And the theme of the Biennale Forum this year is also connected to the curatorial approach that being developed by Wardrop as the curator of the 13th edition of the Biennale Jogja, where he creates lots of participatory, interactive, and social engaged art practices. So most of the conversation during the next 3 days, the first day we do it here in, this is the Societat Militaire, it's part of the Jogja Art Center, and in the next 2 days we will do it in postgraduate of the Indonesian Institute of the Art. So we will have more discussion in the next 3 days around this practice on how this new curatorial approach is being discussed in the relevance of Yogyakarta art scene. Dari saya itu aja, terima kasih sekali atas kedatangan teman-teman dan antusiasmenya yang sangat besar. Kami sangat berbangga hati bahwa ada lebih dari 120 orang pendaftar pada acara ini dan akan bertahan sampai hari Kamis besok. Jadi terima kasih sekali atas partisipasi teman-teman, dan saya harap bagi teman-teman yang belum menonton Biennale-nya sendiri bisa datang ke Jogja Museum, Jogja National Museum setelah ini, karena saya kira menonton pameran itu menjadi pengantar yang sangat penting untuk bisa terlibat dalam diskusi-diskusi dalam hari-hari mendatang. Terima kasih, dan saya kembalikan ke Arsita. Ya.
Terima kasih, Arya Sastika. Thank you. And selanjutnya saya akan langsung memanggil moderator dan juga adalah direktur dari Simposium Katulistiwa, yaitu Enin Suprianto. And next I please Enin Suprianto as the moderator and also the director of Equator Symposium, and also give the forum to Enin Suprianto.
Thank you. Good morning. Ladies and gentlemen, friends and colleagues, my name is Enin Suprianto. I'm the curator and project officer of the Equator Symposium, a program initiated and organized by Yogyakarta Biennale Foundation. We are very pleased and honored to present this lecture session today as part of the Biennale Forum in the third edition of Equator Biennale, Yogyakarta Biennale 2015. We are also proud and very happy that our distinguished guest, Mr. Nicolas Bourriaud from France, is able to be here with us today to be our guest lecturer for this session. Before we start our program, I would like to ask all of us to be conscious about the tragic event, the atrocities that happened last Friday, November 13, in Paris. I would like to ask all of you to stand up, please. And to send our deepest empathy, condolences, and support to all families and friends of the victims in Paris and in many other parts of our world, in Palestine, Syria, Kenya, and our very own country, Indonesia, where so many people are still experiencing violence and cruel acts against humanity. Please join me for 30 seconds in a moment of silence. Thank you. Please be seated. Now, allow me to explain briefly about the Equator Symposium before I introduce our guest lecturer. As I mentioned earlier, the Equator Symposium is one of the main programs of Yogyakarta Biennale Foundation. The symposium is international in scale, involving artists, academics, activists from various nations, including in the breadth scope of the equatorial belt. Within the framework of gathering, as well as dispersing critical discourses. The symposium is across or inter or even transdisciplinary, while maintaining its attentions on the various phenomena of contemporary art practices. In other words, we position contemporary art as a verb, or at least as an open space. It is inclusive and ready to accept various critical elements, opening itself onto opportunities of engagement with various disciplines and fields. The symposium is also our strategic effort to develop networks amongst artists, academics, curators, researchers, activists, individuals, and collectives who committedly involve in the development of Indonesian contemporary art scenes so that they can meet and engage with their contemporaries from various parts of the world. We have conducted our first editions of the symposium last year, 2014, and the next edition will be next year. Now, allow me to take your attention to our distinguished guest lecturer for today's program, Mr. Nicholas Borio. I hope I do justice to your track records. I presume that most of us know Nicholas Borio's name from his book, Relational Aesthetic, which was originally published in 1998. Back then, and most likely until today, this book is an important text in our contemporary art world. In this book, he questions and explains extensively the various phenomena that happen within the area of contemporary art practices, in which postmodern or even postcolonial theories were unable to explain or had tried to do so insufficiently. Relational aesthetic, a phrase that he coined, had been acknowledged as a divining term for a wide variety of artworks created and produced by a new generation of artists who came to prominence in early 1990s in Europe, especially in Europe. With his critical outlook, he presents us with an important interpretative critique of our time. In this decade, he established himself as an important theorist and creator, actively works in many important art events, while at the same time, he continuously published his seminals writings. Some of his most important published work are, respectively, Post-Production, 2002, Playlist, 2004, Radikan, 2009, and Ultramodern, 2009. In short, his practice as creators and his theoretical proposal has instigated rich discussions about the relationship between, let's say, life and contemporary art. Most recently, with his typical thought-provoking approach, he put forward issues regarding the relationship between humans, machines, and nature, as presented in Taipei Biennale 2014, in which he was the appointed artistic director curator, titled The Great Accelerations, Art in the Anthropocene. Nicholas Borio co-founded the Palais de Tokyo with Jerome Sans in 1999 in Paris. He served as co-director of the institution until 2006. He founded the contemporary art magazine Document sur l'Art and also worked for Flash magazine for 8 years as the Paris-based correspondent until 1995. Then in 2008 to 2010, he was appointed as the Gulbenkian Curator of Contemporary Art at Tate Britain. With all his records and achievements, he established himself as one of the most important curators in Europe today. He created the Tate Britain Triennial, Ultramodern, in 2009, and then the third Athens Biennale, 2013, with Xenia Kalpaksoglu and Pokayu, and then in Asia, as the creator of Taipei Biennale 2014, and the most recent one, the 10 editions of Kaunas Biennale in Lithuania, which is still going on until early December this year. So here we are today with Nicolas Bourriaud to learn further from his experience, his insightful thoughts and ideas about contemporary art today, the ever-expanding boundaries and the contingencies of contemporary art. Without further delay, I would like to invite Mr. Nicolas Bourriaud to deliver his lecture. Please extend your warmest welcoming applause to Mr. Nicolas Bourriaud.
Thank you very much. I'm very happy to be here in this context. I don't know if it works, and I have to compete with a very important air conditioning device, which I'm going to try to put it to. It's very relevant if you in terms of the theme of this the talk I'm going to do today. It's interesting to see that this machine actually, well, that's a dialogue, is in a robotic and mechanical context, which is the really big substract of this lecture.
It's actually the Taipei Biennial last year came out of something which actually was very much present 2 years ago, and which made me think again about relational aesthetics and what it was, you know, almost 15 years before now. It was quite important to re-see and re-read those theories in context which has been completely different. Actually, let's think that when I wrote this book, Facebook didn't exist, you know, social networks didn't exist, actually. The mechanical and digital environment, as we know it now, was not actually existing. And it only, let's say, comforted the intuitions contained in the book and added new themes to it, which actually are contained in the exhibition. So one thing which is very important is that I'm not a philosopher, I try to be a curator who writes, which is a very different thing. I tend to like, actually, and have some interest in intellectuals who actually have a practical grip on the world. It can be Jacques Lacan, actually was a psychoanalyst, but a theoretician. Walter Benjamin was a critic, not a philosopher. He called himself a private thinker, and I think that corresponds to me quite well. So, curator means going back and forth between words and forms, between the visual and the text, between ideas and the way artists produce or refract them. It depends. That's my position, which is the position of a seahorse, in a way, you know, in between things. You know, I'm trying to pass ideas. And everything I ever wrote is coming from the studios, from the artist studios. And I'm trying to translate what I see into concepts and words. And that's the way, actually, I try to work. So that's why books and exhibitions have a very specific dialogue in my universe. Because, actually, I just start with artist studios and artworks, exhibitions. You try to understand what you see, you try to invent the greed that will allow other people to understand it the same way you do. And then, obviously, you try to make an exhibition and it never totally corresponds. Because there's no artwork that can be contained into ideas. Otherwise, it's a bad one, actually, frankly. And it happens a lot of times. But great artworks have this ability to escape from any definition, from any theory, I would say, even. You can catch a part of them, but not all of them. It's the kind of rule, actually. So that's why I wrote Relational Aesthetics about, let's say, I tried to describe the work of 20, 25 artists, same generation than me, actually. And I wrote the second book, Post-Production, which is a totally different idea, but actually I took the exact same artists, you know, as examples, just to show also that there's no idea that can completely spoil or exhaust the content of an artwork. So that's kind of important to understand that artworks and artists are caught into crossfires of ideas, networks of ideas, networks of possible interpretations. And the interpretation is infinite in somehow. Well, concerning great artworks. Because what is an artwork, actually? You know, that's something I started with talking in Bandung, but it's also something that you can go on about. It's a signal. You have one individual or a group that sends a signal. And what makes a signal exist? It's, for example, it can be just light. Light is a signal, can be smoke, whatever. But the artwork is a very sophisticated signal. What makes a signal exist? It's energy. If you want the signal to be prolongated and to exist for a long time, you need energy to sustain it. And that's a universal physical rule. What makes us still interested in artworks coming from the 1,000 years ago, 1 century ago? It's the energy that was actually put into action and which makes us still interested in so many artists, actually, that we can see in museums. No need to make a list. And this energy is also associated with complexity. We are still interested in looking at Rembrandt or Marcel Duchamp, Vermeer, whoever, because the complexity of the image makes it the work actually inexhaustible. It's impossible to exhaust it. No, it's still self-propelled by its own energy, because you cannot, you know, stop interpreting it in a way. So we all still can do new interpretations of Leonardo da Vinci, Piero della Francesca, whoever, you know, and whatever artwork you can mention. It's coming from this huge amount of energy that is actually accompanying any artwork. And the nature of this energy is what I call beauty. What we call beauty, actually, is nothing but that. And it's not necessarily formal beauty. It's not nice. It's not lovely. It's beauty is energy. And that's the introduction I wanted to make for this talk. What I wanted to start with, and what I wanted to address today in this very interesting context, is more or less the set of ideas that were contained in the Taipei Biennial. And it's not by random if doing this exhibition in Asia made me reconsider completely the problematics of relational aesthetics. In a way, it's true that relational aesthetics had been accused of being anthropocentric by a new generation of philosophers that call themselves speculative realism. And that's the starting point, actually, of the exhibition. What does it mean to be anthropocentric? And is it anthropocentric? Is this book anthropocentric? And what does it imply in the philosophical terms? That was the starting point of my reflection that led to the exhibition. And there was no better image or no better concept to fuel this exhibition than this very quite recent geological concept. It's a scientific concept born in the 1980s. At this time, some scientists said that we were entering into a new geological era, which was succeeding to what has been called Holocene, and we're entering into the Anthropocene. Anthropos in Greek mean human being. The Anthropocene is the geological era which is characterized by the fact that human activities have a super strong impact on the geological and environmental context of the planet. Massive deforestation, pollution of the soil, of the sea, of the air, which is causing what we call global warming. The melting of the great glaciers, which changes completely also the climate of the planet. The biosphere being altered by the action of our species is leading to what scientists call Anthropocene, which is a new way to understand also our position as human beings on this planet, which puts everything into question in some ways. Because the impact of our activities is today more powerful than any other natural force. So what does it mean? What can we still stand the idea of this very Western opposition between nature and culture? And that was the starting point of my reflection. Because there's something that needs to be fully understood and which is really important, is the fact that the birth of the Western thought and Western civilization as it was created, let's say, and really taking its full speed at the 15th, 16th century, is actually born out of this idea that the human being is at the top of the pyramid of beings. This opposition between nature on one side and culture, us human beings, on the other, cannot be separate from the Western, you know, colonialism. Even it's something which is absolutely, you know, at the core of Western thought. And I think that's this very idea that needs to be completely, you know, shattered and destroyed today. And for this, we need to enter into a new multi-log, let's say, kind of plurilog on the planet. Because what does it mean, the Anthropocene? It means, first, a crisis of the human scale. And I think we all experience that today. Because on one side, yes, our activities are impacting the whole climate and the whole planet. That's one thing. But on the other hand, we are more and more numerous as human beings, and we tend to feel completely helpless in front of the world in general. We are living into a computerized economic system which is animated by algorithms, and that's the very important element, actually. Let's think that 75% of the operations in the financial sector in the US today, 75% is made by algorithms. It's operations which are made at the speed of light and which necessitate no human beings at all. So 75% of the financial sector in the US, I don't have the numbers for the rest of the world, but it's more or less the same, doesn't contain any human intervention. That's something, as far as I know. That's a data that we can start thinking from. Because it seems that human beings have become spectators and victims, in a way, of the infrastructure they have actually built. Spectators of an economy which is detached from any production on the human scale. And what is really, I think, typical of our times is this really spectacular reduction of the human scale. And this situation contributes to the emergence of a new way of thinking, according to me. In a way, today, we could see the emergence of a new political coalition, in some ways, between us, the individuals, human beings, and what could be called a new subordinate class, including animals, including plants, nature, minerals, the atmosphere, because we all are imperiled by a techno-industrial system that is clearly detached from civil society today. So the theme of the Anthropocene is not only a scientific theme. It appears as a revelation of the disquieted consciousness of us inhabitants of the world, where the atmosphere itself has come under threat today. So we are driven to renegotiate, in a way, our presence on this planet with all its inhabitants, which is not only human beings. We are surrounded by other types of beings. And I think we cannot think without them today. And that's the main characteristics of today's philosophy. Anthropocene represents a new set of parameters of our relationship with all the forces with which we must coexist on this planet. And that was the starting point of the exhibition, The Great Acceleration, because the scientists who actually talk about the Anthropocene also consider the absolutely spectacular acceleration of this impact, since World War II, mainly. Every year we can see the acceleration of this of those consequences on the planet. I was quoting it the other day, but it's a very important data too. Today, for example, there are more machines roaming the internet than human beings. And that's the first time also in history since the apparition of internet in 1991, 1992. We are overseeded by machines, actually. We have algorithms and robots who actually can communicate sometimes between each other, without the presence of the human being. And what are we in this context? That's interesting. Human beings on the internet is reduced to the status of personal data, which is used by big corporations, actually, as information, and which is the matter of the economy today. So what are we, human beings, like animals trapped by those robots while looking for our data? So it's something we have to think about too. And all those elements I mentioned are actually part of what I'd have to call a new relational landscape. And that was the main element. It was impossible for me to go on thinking about relational aesthetics without getting deeper and further into this new context, which is totally changed since 1995, which is the moment I started working on it. Because human beings seem to occupy a very secondary position, a position of raw material, I would say, to the digital economy, which is the same level of importance as fossil fuels, livestock, or sunlight, for example. That's what we are, actually, in this perspective. So this contributes to the emergence of a new paradigm. And that was this new paradigm that was trying to discuss and show in this exhibition in Taipei. But I have to make a little detour with emerging philosophies of today also. And I've been mentioning briefly what has been called speculative realism. Let's say, let's call it, you know, so it's more talking, object-oriented philosophy. That's another name for it. And it's a group of philosophers. I won't get into the details today, but it's an important movement. We seek to establish a relationship of equivalence between the various components of physical reality. I would say, for example, I will get deeper into it a bit later, but there are other elements in the actuality of contemporary art which also are relevant. Categories appearing in the art world, like animism, for example, transhumanism, post-internet art, a lot of new trends and movements which are actually more or less going into the same direction. An American philosopher, Levi Bryant, published a book called The Democracy of Objects. And the main idea, which is quite well summing up this new set of object-oriented philosophies, says that there is only one type of objects, of beings, sorry. There's only one type of beings, objects. And I quote Levi Bryant, "This essay attempts to think an object for itself that isn't an object for the gaze of a subject." Important. "That isn't an object for the gaze of a subject, representation, or a cultural discourse. The claim that all objects equally exist is the claim that no object can be treated as constructed by another object. In short, no object such as the subject of or culture is the ground of all others." That's the raw idea, I would say, behind these object-oriented philosophies. There's only one type of beings, objects. This we can discuss, and we will later. But I'm trying to sum up the position of those people. Bruno Latour, the French philosopher, talks about the parliament of things also, and he's a very important thinker for our times. But I wanted to address those topics through two artists, which were, in a way, the totems of this exhibition, but who are not in the exhibition, actually. One is the French artist Pierre Wig, and the other the British artist Mark Leakey. But I don't have images, but maybe, anyway, what I want to expresses the way they see their practice and the way they express it. Mark Leakey calls for a relationship with objects which would be freed from the mediation of language. And I quote him, Mark Leakey says, "You can talk about or involve yourself with objects without continuous recourse to concepts and critique. Not only approaching them as though they are only organized by language, by us, you can try and empathize with them on a whole other level." On the other hand, another artist, Pierre Huyghe, who did a very important exhibition in end of 2013 at the Pompidou Center and then at LACMA in Los Angeles, based on the same principle, Pierre Huyghe has focused on animal life, and in its exhibitions, you can really see and participating in a way, between brackets, bees, dog, mollusks, for example, or even bacteria, because he's been doing a project with the virus of flu, for example. It's all part of the exhibition. There is no distinction between that no degrees of beings in his exhibition. You know, a dog is at the same level than an object, which is at the same level than a human being. You see this new horizontalization of the landscape of beings, which is, I think, the strongest point in his world. Because he's proposing what he calls a world without humans in these exhibitions, in which life would come into being through the production of forms, which creates a kind of unpredictable and accidental, sometimes, dimension. Doing this, I think he reverses the conventions between the artist and the viewer in some way, between objects and human consciousness. Because he's affirming, and that's the main point, which is the beginning of my reflection about it, he affirms that an exhibition is not meant, I quote, "to exhibit something to someone, but to exhibit someone to something." That's important. Not to exhibit something to someone, like a very normal exhibition is, in a way, but he tries to reverse the proposition. He's exhibiting someone to something. In other words, he thinks of art as an experience, in a way. What is an exhibition? It's an experience. What is art? It's not a set of objects which are disposed in a room, which are displayed in a space. It's an experience. And it's what you, as viewers, beholders, participants, will get out of it, which makes art. And what I just said means that there is no art without human beings. And we'll come back on it. Art as experience, then. And this experience is defined in Huyghe's exhibitions by a kind of absolute contingency, because you cannot control completely a dog or a bee or a virus. No, it's impossible. Contingency, random, is something which is part of the experience, like in life, actually. And the viewer is the beholder. It is seen by Pierre Huyghe not as only a participant, and that's more important. He or she is an active witness. You have to witness what you saw, because that's the goes with the experience. If you experience something, you have to witness it. Or it's not really an experience. Then. Active witness is the status of the beholder in Pierre Huyghe's exhibitions. And when Mark Leakey, on the other hand, I take my second example artist, he evokes a direct and empathetic relationship with the object, which is not organized by language, I insist. That's where maybe I don't agree, in a way. Doing so, he is in the same field than Cézanne or Giacometti, in some ways, were actually both trying in the 19th and 20th century, or you can say Shitao, you know, even before. No, that's exactly the same idea. Trying to penetrate the secret structures of the visible through the process of deconditioning the gaze. You know, that's what they were actually trying to do. And that's what those artists today can also perpetuate in a very different way. So to define his own explorations, Pierre Wieck makes use of a very similar phrase, sentence. The purpose of art, he says, is to, I quote, I had the impression that this was doing beep, you know, which is really strange. So I'm talking about kind of coexistence of multiple beings, you know, you get hallucinations like that. Well, I'll come back to what Pierre Wieck says about art. He says, the purpose of art, and I really love this sentence, is to, between brackets, I quote, increase the presence of what is. And that's a very beautiful way of saying things, I think. Art implies to increase the presence of what is. We are actually not far from the ambition of Cézanne in the 19th century. And that's really important for me to make links, you know, between contemporary art and art of the past, you know, because it's, for me, I see more the similarities than the differences. You can think only about what's different, but we can also make connections with art from the 15th century, talking about an artist of today. And that's, I think, really important to do so. It's not another type of art. Contemporary art is not something which is detached from history. You know, it's really echoes, you know, things which are actually coming from very far. Just an example, monochrome paintings, for example. You know, look at tantric art from the 17th century in India, and you will find monochrome paintings much way before you know, Malevich or Rothko or whoever you want. I know. Mark Leakey talks about techno-animism, and that's a very good example of it, actually. Techno-animism, you know, so you have machines having a voice, actually, trying to engage discussion with you. It's good to have examples on your, under your hand. And I quote again Mark Leakey, actually, which will give us another aspect of this will to engage with reality more or less the same way than people like Cézanne or Giacometti or Shitao were doing in the past. I quote, approaching an object as if it has some essential property that the artist attempts to draw out of it isn't something taught at art school anymore. It's not totally true, actually. Isn't something taught at art school anymore. But now I feel we've entered a strange new sensory realm, the vivid and mortal sensations created by the convincing visual surface texture of HD, the warm regard you feel towards your stamped metal devices, or the aboriginal shudder you get watching, paradoxically, cold, autistic cyberspace takes us back to an appreciation of sensuality. And that's a very, very paradoxical and very interesting way to describe our digital surroundings. We are, in a way, surprised anew, surprised again by the presence of the world through the resources provided by our nervous system. If Mark Leakey intends to approach objects without any recourse to language or describe their interconnections, you know, because he, you know, one of his previous exhibitions called The Universal Addressability of Dumb Things, he actually refers to a concept from information technology that a network of objects could communicate without the intervention of an agent with consciousness, without the intervention of a human being, in a way, or animal, or any thing, any that would have a consciousness. But we see that, anyway, all day long, what's connected machines, connected servers, connected robots. No, today it's something which absolutely functions. And it's something also that we actually tend to discover, between brackets, but that idea and all the ideas I've been discussing here actually are also contained in very ancient civilizations that we totally despised till now, but I will be back on it a bit later. So what is the common point between the two artists I mentioned before? I think that the main common point and the center of this new art scene is the fact that actually both, if you rethink about the quotations I made, they both are destroying this very classical idea, which also is one of the pillars of Western thought, which is subject-object. What is a subject, what is an object? All the philosophy since the Greek philosophers of the antiquity is based on this idea in the Western world. I insist on this. Subject on one side and the object. It is something that has been spread out also. It's contaminated other types of civilization and ways of seeing. But this is today, but completely in crisis by contemporary art. And it's really important to see that it's a core, the core of the aesthetic debate today. Maybe there's no such thing as subject, object, you know, as we know it. It seems also that the human thought is turning into things at the moment, as if it was in search for a new equilibrium, in a way. And it happens at the very moment when, I repeat, our species has become aware of its disastrous action and disastrous takeover of the planet. And it's not by random. The human existence has been structured over the course of centuries in the Western world around a reassuring face-to-face exchange between the ego and the world. And that's what seems to be completely problematical. And that's where we can reasonably call for a new and that's what I tried to did in the exhibition Altermodern in 2009. I think time has come for the emergence of a new modernity that would not be based on Western, you know, presupposed ideas, but on a dialogue that would be, for the first time in history, global. And it's possible to do it today. And I think it's actually emerging more and more. And what we're seeing, the most interesting part of this global dialogue, is this very tight negotiation and dialogue and translation, permanent translation of ideas, which, according to me, is producing a new type of modernity. And that's what we actually all participate to at the moment. It's really here. And that's what I call alter-modern. The specific modernity for the 21st century, not the modernism or modernity from the 20s, which was a kind of Western concept which actually progressed exactly like the movement of colonization, actually, like a kind of code over every local tradition. What would be interesting today is to start from it, from local specificities, and to be able to co-build a new type of modernity that will be based on Esperanto, but on translation and dialogue. And the set of ideas that are discussed in this exhibition, and that I tried to express through the quotations of Kelly and Mark Leakey, is absolutely part of it today. How much time do I have? I forgot my... Five? Okay, it was the introduction. Okay. It's the art of ending beautifully is something which is difficult, you know, especially if you're just started actually to...
Right.
What's really important? Yeah, I think the primal scene of those philosophies oriented object I mentioned before, which is the disappearance of the subject object correlation. That's the main idea. It's exactly, it's the opposite of the omnipresence of the gaze, as we can see when we experience an exhibition, for example. And what it does represent, these ideas of a complete disappearance of the subject-object relationship, is also a world in which language has no place. And if you read all the philosophers that are actually mentioned, all those people participating to this new philosophical trend, what is completely missing is the idea of language. There's no mention of the notion of language in their works. And I think that's absolutely paradigmatic. No. And that's where I don't agree, because I think at the opposite that we could completely envision a new set of relationship between humans, animals, nature in general, and even machines, based on this idea of language. Because it's interesting to see that in the history of structuralism, 53 is a very important date. It's the year Jacques Lacan, turned psychoanalysis into the structuralist world, saying that the unconscious is structured as a language. Same year was the discovery of the DNA code. That's this coincidence is very interesting. And DNA, our DNA, anything's DNA. What is it? It's a code. Just something you have to decipher, and which develops into its language. And that's the primary structure of language, which is encoded within the very core of reality. So how can we evacuate language as such? It's impossible to me. And that's what I'm trying to do now. Actually, that's my next step, is to reevaluate all those ideas according to the primacy of language, not human language only, but language in general. It speaks. It's not us who only speak. It speaks. And maybe the artist is the one who is able to decode all those languages that we actually are surrounded with and not being able to talk. We need someone to translate. And the artist, the figure of the artist as an omni translator, is something that really interests me. Completely, that's what I'm working on at the moment. I briefly talked about structuralism. I'm also trying to come back to it, actually, at the moment. It's been undervalued for a long time, and people talk, especially in America, about post-structuralism as way more important, but I don't agree completely about it. I reread Claude Lévi-Strauss at the moment, and I found a very interesting idea, which is that the ultimate goal of human science, structuralist human studies, is not the human being, but cultural systems on one side. But it's not about constituting the human being, it's to dissolve him or her. The activity, the structuralist human studies, you know, idea is to dissolve the figure of the human being, who is not at the top of the pyramid of beings. So I think we are facing, and I will finish on this, we are facing a dilemma today. Either we go on thinking about nature and our atmospherical surroundings as the enemy, as we do for centuries now, all over the world, almost, and that would lead us to the culture of the cyborg. That's the logical conclusion of it, of the kind of coupling between machine and human beings. Or we are able to envision the idea that we are part of nature, and there is not such a thing as a division between nature and culture, which is a totally artificial division. Another misunderstanding that upon which the technical progress ideology of the Western world has been based upon, actually. And that's something we might learn now from, I don't know, from all of the cultural specific cultural scenes, even could be the Dayak, for example, who have not been contaminated by these ideas. And I think this dilemma lays a part of our future, and art is exactly in the middle of it, you know, as, again, this position of the translator that might be, according to me, a very important element for the constitution of the figure of the artist in the 20th century, the 21st century. Well, I will end on it. Thank you.
Thank you, Nicholas. The session for today will be in three parts, so we just end with the first part. And for the second part, I would like to invite some friends to engage, to get involved in very brief conversations with Nicholas. First of all, I would like to invite Agung Hujatnika from the Bandung Institute of Technology, the former curator of Jogja Biennale 2013, and then Alia Sostika, the director of the Jogja Biennale, and the third one, our colleagues, Antareksa from Kunci Cultural Studies, please take a seat at the stage. Again, thank you, Nicholas, for that very thought-provoking presentation. I think our artist friends would be very delighted with your proposal because they will have that very influential and core positions in constructing our world today and for the future. And at the end of your presentations, you definitely mentioned the possibility of artists and artworks as translator, as translator of a new kind of communications, a new kind of language that can be activated through the existence of artworks, in which the positions of the spectators between subject and object will be somehow diminished because it's become a communication that support the very idea of coexistence between beings. I would like to invite, let's say, Agung to make a brief comment or even questions about the whole, any part of the presentation. And then Antariksa, and then Arya.
Thank you, Emin. I think I would like to respond to the presentation with maybe two questions. First is, you mentioned earlier about the criticism from the speculative realist philosophers on the fact that relational aesthetics being very anthropocentric. While I think some of us here, a few artists that I know, at least, really kind of refer to the relational aesthetic as a way, as a new way to kind of approach the fact that there has been a very hierarchical opposition between artists and the audience. You know, it's a kind of problem that some of the artists that I know try to solve by referring to the new relational positions. So I wonder whether some of your thoughts in the presentation really kind of react to the criticism of these speculative realist philosophers. Maybe I'll start with that one first.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Otherwise.
Yes.
It does. No. And it's obviously a critic. Remember that this quotation of Levi Bryant, which is a very good summing up of the positions, which is, there's only one type of being, objects. That's the core of my critique, actually. Is the object the right angle from which you can redistribute the coexistence of all beings on Earth? I'm not sure of this, because this is exactly the discourse of capitalism, transforming everything into objects. That's exactly the dream for Bill Gates, no? That's exactly what he dreamed of. And that's what big corporations dream of, you know? No friction between, for trading. Human beings are, in a way, a bit, you know, the most worrying element of this circuit, you know? Objects are much better to handle, you know? That's clear. And in a world where it's possible to put a copyright on a seed or an Amazonian plant, for example, are we sure that the dimension of the object is the philosophical dimension we want to go on with? I'm not sure.
Can you elaborate more about what's wrong of being very anthropocentric from this philosopher's point of view?
Well, but being anthropocentric means that you give a precedence of for human beings above any other form of beings, actually. That's being anthropocentric. That's putting the human being, that's the classical Western position, which is completely anthropocentric, except that Copernic in the, already showed the human beings that they were not at the center of the world, and Freud told them at the beginning of 20th century that they were not even the masters of their own mind. So it's good for it's bad for ego, but still anthropocentrism is, I would say, certainly not the answer. It's the part of the problem, not the answer.
Is Andreksen?
Thank you, Nicholas, for your lecture and presentation. I wish I could see the images of words that you mentioned during your presentation. I have at least maybe two or three comments. Maybe also a question of critique. First, you mentioned a lot about the new, or you propose the new type of relational aesthetic, because the changing nature of our world today, we have what you call as a new language towards machine. Technology, and animals, and a lot of beings, or even objects. First, my comments related to the recent state of technology. I can see that you are missing one thing, because your proposition. Is based on the equality of access towards technology. While, for example, in many countries in the world, we still don't have access to technology. So for me, it is highly important to take a look closer to the political and economic history of technology. Because by researching more into the political and economical composition of the power behind the technology, I think we could understand more what kind of language that we should develop towards this new relational aesthetic. That's number one. So I'd like to hear your comments about the political history of the technology, especially in the changing composition of world power today. And that's number one. Number two, you mentioned a lot about anthropomorphism and Anthropocene. I do believe that you are aware with the history of Eastern philosophy. Anthropomorphism is not a new philosophy. It's deep-rooted in Hinduism, for example. So the idea of having new language together for human beings to develop new conversation with animals, with things, even with new technology, is not really new. In Asian countries, for example, in Bali, people have hundreds of ceremony towards metal, towards soil, books, animals, trees, everything. That's not new, but with recent tendencies in Western philosophy. We're trying actually to recreate something that's actually already there. My question is why? it is because the long history of colonialism, for example, so that's why the Western philosophy, they have their own way to develop new theories, new understanding towards new relational state of the world today, or I don't know, is it, I actually a little bit worried that this kind of penetration of new Western political or philosophical theory is new kind of, I don't know, colonization. I'm a little bit worried because actually we is already here. For example, the notion of, you know, relational aesthetics, it's part of our life, but somehow it's being, you know, theoreticized or maybe over theoreticized because of you. and then suddenly we feel like this is a new thing, and then sadly we are in Asia at least, or in Africa, I know some friends in Africa or in South America, we're trying to look ourselves with your theory, which is for me it's a little bit silly. Because I think the first thing we need to do is to look our own history.
Why don't you do it?
Yes, that's what we are trying to do. Oh. But the thing is, because of the political imbalance. So my point is how we move forward this, you know, silly tension between East and West, and rather than focusing ourselves in one or two or a particular theory, I propose we need to move towards, I don't know, political revolution. That's my proposal.
First, I think it's very interesting intervention, because it's the really, really core of the what I'm trying to say. Actually, I insisted at least twice during this talk on the fact that those presupposed way of envisioning things is purely Western, and I think that's the core of it. But it's also very ethnocentric of you to think that, you know, for example, the Balinese postulation towards art and everyday life is only, you know, Asian, because it's not true at all. Actually, look back into the ancient Greece, for example, you know, we will find Diogenes, you know, and many others. You will find also equal, you know, types of behavior and attitudes toward life. So let's not replace an ethnocentrism by another one. I think that's important. It's not about being ethnocentric anymore. What I'm calling for is, and I also said it at least twice, a dialogue. You know? And that's not by random. If those types of ideas came from a biennial, actually that was in Asia. And that was really my obsession during this process, was rather to find a common ground, not for a consensus, because I don't like consensus, no, it's boring, no, it's not absolutely no interest, no, but this very specific place from where you can develop contradictions and different set of opinions and ideas. That's what we have to look for, not for who was the first or who's right. It's boring. No, it's not interesting at all. And when you say that relational aesthetics existed before, you know, and I cannot agree with that. No, because it, of course, no, it's like a theory is not a discovery. It's a way of telling things. You know, a theory in Latin means a defile of things. And that's an interesting way of saying it. You know, it's the organization of a procession, in a way. That's what theory is in the etymology of theory in Latin. So, obviously it was there, but it was there in the Western world too, not only in the Hinduists, for example, or Buddhists, for example. I'm quite familiar with Indian philosophy, for example. And obviously you can find many things, like even did lectures about Buddhism and art, like which is super important pattern for the 20th century art. You can see that in Marcel Duchamp, in John Cage, Robert Filliou, many others. And those type of dialogues are actually filling, providing contents which are really strong. But what does it mean it already exists? No. Because what I described in this book is the apparition of a new generation of artists working specifically on this. You can find examples of world artworks which are more or less close to this idea, you know, like Elio Itichica in Brazil, you know, in the 1960s, Tom Marioni in California in 70. But the difference is that those artists were actually aware of that idea and put it on the form, actually. And that's very different. To give you an example, you can find prototypes of pop art in the 1930s. Stuart Davis, Gerald Murphy, even Fernand Léger somehow, you know? Of course. But it was not pop art yet, because that's not conscious of being pop art. That's the main difference. And you can see examples of relational art, you know, before the 90s, but it's not the same, because it was not conscious, actually. The hierarchy, actually, of concepts, which changes everything.
Maybe I want to continue what is being mentioned by Antariksa. For example, I know that you were in Jakarta also before, and like if we discuss further the questions from Antariksa on how your theory of relational aesthetic, for example, being applied in the context of Indonesia, because I agree with Antariksa that a lot of things is being redefined within, in a way, your framework or the theory. But maybe it's not like, it's not really that we are blaming you for what is happening here, but it's also the way we perceive also the new theory or the new definition of our own practice, actually, that is quite problematic. So do you think that when you were in Jakarta, do you see those kind of practices of the art that you saw in the Jakarta Biennale also define the relational aesthetic? That is one. And then the second one, I want to ask you, like, starting from your latest statement where you mentioned artist as translator, and then I want to go back also to your first or your opening statement about you see the beauty as energy. How do you relate these two phenomena? Like, when you talk about language and how artists should create a new language, and how this language can be part of our new beauty or new definition of beauty. Because also I think there is this big shifting of the idea of beauty within centuries. Because I feel also like when you say when you mention the examples of the works of Pierre Huy, it's also quite different contexts of what we have here. Like, for example, Antariksa mentioned that the idea to speak with animals or the natural landscape actually something that we have already practiced as part of the Eastern philosophies. But at the same time also, I think the works of Pierre Huy, as I experience it, is different. I experience it in a different level. It's not only to question my position as individual towards the landscape, but it's more also to question my individuality as a self on my own. So that is quite different also. And I think I want to hear also how you define PRQE practice, for example, here more in the context of the art history rather than in connection to social context or the natural landscape.
First, it's interesting to see that we're using a lot the word new here now, and that's pure contamination actually of the ideology of progress in art, you know, which is really coming also from the Western world. So maybe we should envision things differently. You know, what is new? Like Georges Brecht, you know, the Fluxus artist, was saying that it's much more difficult to be the ninth person to do something than the first one. Because if you want to be the ninth one, you have to aim very well. And it's much more difficult. So new is a concept which is, you cannot separate from a very specific ideology, which was actually active, radical ideology, which was for me an ideology from the 20th century in the Western world. So that's one element. Talking about relational aesthetics and its effect, as I said, you know, the idea of this book was to develop, produce, let's say, a grid of reading for a very specific amount of young artists who were actually working together at this time. So it's not a kind of recipes book, you know, which is supposed to be applied by anyway. It's the description of something which is actually emerging, you know, and that's it. You know? And then, if it gives ideas, if it provides a theoretical frame for other artists, that's fine. But that's nothing more than a toolbox. You know, you can do exactly what you want out of it, and that's the idea. You know, one should be feel free in front of those theories, because just coming from the studios, coming from the exhibitions, you know, and just my position is the one who tries to translate also. Well, I translate what the artist, you know, translates himself or herself, you know. It's a chain of translation. And I'm only the one who tries to decipher in a specific language, which is the language of theory. And this idea of translation is of an infinite richness for me. You know, it's something which is a poetics even for me. What's interesting in translation, first, is the fact that not everything is translatable. There's always something which remains. You know? Some words you have in Bahasa Indonesia or in Chinese or in English or cannot be translated in another language. That's what interests me a lot. But it doesn't mean that you cannot understand them. No, those notions can be explained, you know, so, and you can turn around them. And misunderstandings even are interesting. You know? It does produce many interesting things, even visual misunderstandings. For example, talking about visual misunderstandings, the American artists of the 40s, mid 40s, late 30s even, understood surrealism and some abstraction, you know, European abstraction, out of black and white photographers. You know, they only had black and white photographs, you know, to see what was going on in Europe at the time. So they had no idea of the dimensions of the work. They had no idea of the colors, neither. And the people like Jackson Pollock or Arshad Gorky or de Kooning even started working, actually, on presupposed, you know, ideas which were completely misunderstandings. And it did produce a great art. So I like this kind of cultural misunderstandings because it's based on translations, you know, Chinese whispers. You know, I say something, you, and you repeat it to him, and then and at the end it will come completely different. So I think this is the basis of this new culture of translation we actually are experiencing, all of us, today, which will produce interesting things. It's putting language into movement. If I translate, I give movement to a text. And that's the most beautiful thing to do. Because, for example, if we don't put an artwork into movement, which means if we don't look at it, if we don't commentate it, it dies. An unwatched artwork is an artwork which doesn't exist anymore, actually. That's the idea of the signal I was mentioning at the very beginning. It's exactly the same. You need energy to propel this signal. If the signal fails, there's no art anymore, just an object that has no particular meaning, that doesn't produce anything anymore. And if art doesn't produce something within you, it doesn't exist, it dies, it's finished. That's the beauty of art, is actually when we look at an artwork, we keep them alive, we keep something alive, we keep values alive, we are the keepers of something. And that's what makes this community of art lovers so important in some ways. The same way that people have to watch over natural elements, the exact same way. And I think it's worth doing it. And to mention this discussion that artists have, for example, with the animal brain. Think about Joseph Beuys in the 1960s, you know, he did this great performance, you know, explaining painting to a dead rabbit, for example, and he had a very specific relationship with the Cotonian forces or natural forces also. You can find, you know, many examples during the 20th century. What I mean is that today, all those ideas are reconfigurating in a very different way than before. And that those reconfigurations that I'm trying to look at, not the core ideas.
In that context, like what makes the works of Pierre Huy, for example, different from what has been done by Joseph Beuys, for example?
There's no, there's nothing in common between the two for me, really nothing. It's like two artists using the color blue, no? Or two artists using a circle. No, they are both dealing with animals, but that's exactly the same thing. There's no common meaning between the two. It's two different worlds completely. And I would have a hard time trying to find a common point, actually, more than differences.
Okay, we'll go through Antariksa and then Agung, and hopefully we still have about half an hour for the audience, so be patient.
Nicholas, I'm pretty much interested when you mentioned about we need dialogue. I do agree with that. But my question will be, what is the condition for the dialogue? For example, you give us a lot of examples from the history of Western art, all of the examples. And then the artwork today pretty much dominated by the idea of you know, Western aesthetic. So I think for me, the how do we create the equal condition to create like real dialogue? Because what can I see now, what is happening now in many places in the world through, you know, international biennales and invited artists from different quote unquote developing countries a lot, but when they put it, it's not really a dialogue. It's like Olympic Games. So it's not dialogue. It's again, at the end of the day, it's competition, which is, I do agree with you, there's ethnocentrism. We fall back to that idea. So my question is, what is the condition for this dialogue to create what you call as new language?
See, the first condition for a dialogue is the end of paranoia. No, and it's important, you know, to bring, I bring what I have on the table. Bring what you have on the table. That's the only condition for a dialogue. There's no other one.
I'd like to go back to what Antariksa stated earlier about the fact that we have our own relational concept in, you know, maybe the traditional like in Bali and so on. I kind of disagree because the fact that, for instance, the way traditional people like use the materials for the offerings, for instance, have already changed a lot. You know, it becomes somehow a kind of routine that these people nowadays who inherit the tradition of using offerings, for instance, they can easily replace or exchange the materials for offerings, for instance, with something else, which somehow, you know, it shows that there is a difference between the relational, you know, like you kind of mentioned earlier, relational situation that happened in the traditional society in the past with what we are witnessing now in the life of, for instance, contemporary Balinese society. So this also brings me to the, I think it brings me back to the example of artist that Nicola mentioned earlier about the techno-animism. The techno-animism, who's the artist again? Mark Leakey, right? So, and this term actually reminds me of a kind of daily happenings when, for instance, my kids, when he plays computer, for instance, and the computer doesn't work, he will really pray, you know. Like in bahasa Indonesia, tolong ya Allah komputer ini nyalain lagi gitu. So it's kind of, you know, it's a totally different kind of relational, you know, situation that we have now compared to what you provoked earlier about, you know, we do have our own relational concept. I think it's totally changed now. So this, you know, also this also reminds me of the works of John Pett, for instance, that he kind of see how the transformation of the relationship between man and machine in the past, which was represented in the way of the sugarcane farmers in Georgia did rituals with the sugarcane factories, with the sugar factories, and the fact that we now have a different ghost in the machine. So this is a response to maybe both of you.
I think, do you have any more comments on that, Nicholas? If not, then we will move to the audience.
Just maybe a last one. It's interesting to talk about ethnocentrism about recently studied, because the cover of it is a Thai artist, Rikri Tiruvanija, for example, and most of the sites are especially coming from Buddhism through Rikri's background, actually. And he was really strong when doing this, because he imported within the context of contemporary art ideas which were completely coming from this philosophical area. And I think that's one of the really important, you know, elements that he actually brought. Not talking about Zolong or also someone coming from Mexico, Gabriel Orozco, who was also very much commentated in the book. So I think, on the contrary, I would say that this is the first, you know, generation of artists that's really, you know, much more plurical than before. I think it was the beginning of it.
A very quick one, but you did mention the importance of local specificity in this context, to somehow construct this new modernity that is.
Okay, now we have the sessions about half an hour, I guess. We still have time. That's the schedule that I have. For the audience, you can, let's say for the first round, I would like to invite three persons from the audience. If you have comments or questions, you can use the microphone either from that side, up front, or this side. Yes, we have one, two from this side. Another one maybe from center at the back. Okay, we can just start with two first. Please, the gentleman with the black shirt, and then, was it, Malcolm. Okay, yeah, so, yes, please.
I'd like to introduce myself. I'm Hari Purnomo. I'd like to ask a question about the language. Language that translated by the artist. To represent the presence of something, does it mean the language of that used by the artist is able to make a judgment of what is the good art that based on a relational aesthetic that explains the art itself an experience to the audience, or a new beauty explained, or and make a judgment about the what is the not a good one about that a judgment.
That's a very simple and great question.
Okay,
yeah, because this is the perfect occasion for me to say something which I really insist on. I have the same set of criterions, in a way, to judge the painting of the 17th century than an artwork by Ruquit to Ravanujan. I don't see the difference. No? It's not because it's not representation, but a presentation. No, you're not obliged to represent. We can, as an artist, you can obviously use reality to express, you know, ideas or sensations or whatever you want to call it. But the set of criterions is actually the same. What does it, in a way, it could be summed up by what does it produce? You know, I love, I don't know, Mondrian or Rembrandt because they, whenever I see, or Matisse even, when I see the their paintings, it does produce something very strong. It makes me think. It makes me, you know, feel things. It does reconfigure my brain cells every time. That's exactly the same with Ruquit to Ravanujan or any relational artist you can think. You know, there's something we should maybe get rid of, is the kind of distinction between rational thought and emotional one. You know, that the idea that our brain is divided in two and we wouldn't be able to unite these two possibilities into one. You know, no, there's not such a thing as emotions on one side and ideas. All ideas are touched with emotions. All emotions are also ideas. So when it comes to judging an artwork, judging being maybe a very strong word, to evaluate it, it's exactly the same. It's a combination of concepts and feelings and sensations, and every artwork should be judged in a way the same way. You know, and it could be summed up by this very simple idea: what does it produce? What does it generate?
Yes, please, Malcolm.
Hello, my name is Malcolm Smith. I'm an artist and I'm also a student here in Georgia. Thank you for your talk. I really enjoyed it. And at a few times my brain totally exploded with things that you said. It was fantastic. So I guess, but I'm frustrated because I feel like you started into describing a new way that artists can practice, and we didn't quite get to looking at the practicalities of how that might work. And I'm really interested to hear more about what you're talking about. So I guess one question that I have on a practical level is about the relationship between cultural production and economic power, and who wears the boots in that relationship, and other forms of power as well, and whether cultural production will always support economic power. And I think you talked about how that's happened in lots of different ways, through how postmodernity ultimately supported a particular shift in the way economics works, and how people are increasingly becoming objects within an economic system, spectators of that system with no power within that system. So I'm wondering if you can talk more about how this new idea of ultramodernity and how artists today and how cultural production can actually challenge that economic power and other forms of power, and if at all it can challenge that power, and if it can, how that challenge might take place.
Very broad question, but I'm trying to answer it with a few examples. I really firmly believe in the correlation between the technological, sociological, economical, you know, context and the arts, because it's something which it's constitutive of our vision of art and the way artists actually can, you know, use new languages, you know, and see the world which surrounds them in a different way. For example, I don't know, inventions sometimes can deeply, you know, impact the way people represent their universe. There wouldn't be impressionism without the invention of photography, for example, in 19th century, because impressionism is photography made painting. You know, it's the constitution of an image through the luminous impact, and that's exactly what impressionism is. That's exactly the possibility of thinking that was actually coming from photography. Same for minimal art in the 60s, which is coming from a new set of industrial materials, you know, and very specific aesthetics also for factories, you know, especially in America in the late 50s and beginning of the 60s. Let's think also that what we call conceptual art in the 1960s cannot be separated from the emergence of the new computer world. 71, for example, is a really important date. It's the year where the microprocessor was invented. And it's the exact year that the Japanese artist On Kawara produced this piece, which is 1 million years. And it's just the notation of 1 million years on a kind of notebook. But it's a piece, if we think about it, which is totally crazy, because nobody will ever read it. No, it exceeds our possibility of seeing. And that's something which is coming from the idea of the computer. No? It goes beyond the capacities of the human being. And that's part of the thing. So, yes, my way of seeing the art is an anthropological way, I would say. I would sum it up like this. Anthropological doesn't mean that the anthropos, the human being, is at the top of the pyramid. That's exactly the opposite of what Lévi-Strauss says about it. No? It's a way of dissolving it into its environment. You know, or to find a relational approach to it.
I'm asking in the specific context of Indonesia, where these changes that have happened globally have made the rich richer and the middle class have more gadgets. But in countries like Indonesia, it's meant that the bulk of the population have been increasingly disenfranchised and have no participation anymore in decision making about their lives and the process of that decision making. And I feel like this is what maybe the Biennale is trying to address. It's like, well, how do we as artists have any, how can we position ourselves in terms of change? And I think also it's a question that maybe the other people up here have been jousting at. It's like, well, what do we do then? Like, how do we challenge constantly just reinforcing the relations of power and reinforcing the economy? Like today, on a practical level, like how do artists do that? Or can we even make that conscious decision?
To add up some another side of that question. So what do you see when you talk about the positions of artists being translator in a certain or specific local condition, socio-economic conditions? Artists probably has more important function if it somehow transforms itself not only as artist but probably also as an activist. The engagement required by his or her own socio-economic condition is completely different. It's not being a translator of beings, of a communication between beings anymore, but it's something much more practical.
I'm not sure of this, actually. And I don't make such a clear distinction between the representation of the world and activism, because for me it's the two sides of the same middle, in a way. Lots of representations in the history of art are also part of an activist system, I think. You know, and you could find many examples of it. So I'm feeling uncomfortable splitting, you know, into the things. There is not such a thing as a world of representations that would be, you know, safe and inoffensive, and etc. It's not true, you know, I think. And there's not a pure, you know, domain of activism on the other side. I think in art, that's why it's interesting, I think. In the art world, those two postulations are actually mixing, you know, all the time. And I cannot see any artwork who's not political, because every artwork translates the conditions of life in a certain place at a given time also. So it's always a reflect of your surroundings as an artist, or a way to escape to these surroundings, which is also political. You know? Whatever you do, anyway, you're political.
Is there any more questions or comments from the audience? Yes, we have one over there. Two, can we start with two, so please? And then later from the back. Thank you.
Hi, thank you for your talk and the discussion panel as well. My name is Ellie Kent, I'm a translator and, an arts translator. I wanted to push you a little bit more on the idea of dialogue that Andrixa raised. I think that it's a little bit simplistic to just say that we need to put away our paranoia, because I think there are a lot of invisible power structures that prevent dialogue at this point, like language and gender and a whole raft of other things. So I'm just, in terms of, I guess, back to the practical nature of things that Malcolm mentioned as well, how do we actually get beyond the paranoia and deal with the invisible power structures and the visible power structures? You can't hear me?
I'm afraid there's no way to fully escape to it. No, but paranoia and suspicion and fear of the other is actually part of the equation. We have to cope with it. There's no ideal world in which there would be a dialogue without friction. And I think it's a very good thing, actually. Here intervenes a very interesting concept. My friend Chantal Mouffe actually is establishing a distinction, which is in political terms very interesting, between antagonism and agonism. And it goes with relational aesthetics for me. Antagonism is an opposition between two ideas so strong that that there is not only a competition but a fight to exclude one of them. No, it's what happens with integrist fanatics, for example. It's us or them, you know, and there cannot be any cohabitation. And then you have agonism, which is, in a way, what a democracy should always be. It's the expression of opposite point of views, but in a common space, where we actually can have a dialogue, you know, without killing each other. That's the least you can do, actually, I think. And then, why not producing new ideas together, born of these oppositions and these contradictions, those impossibilities to power issues also. That's agonism, and that's the state of dialogue, a regime of dialogue that I'm actually referring to.
Is there any more before we move to?
No, I guess it's just the question of who's involved in antagonism and who's involved in agonism, and how do we make sure there's an equal footing for the parties to a dialogue, or that even certain parties that aren't part of the dialogue can come into it. I think there's lots of dialogue that many, many people aren't involved in, or many, many positions aren't represented.
Both spaces, the one of antagonism and the one of agonism, are constituting themselves, you know, in a way, spontaneously, I would say. You know, if you, as long as you express a statement which excludes the other, you're into the position, the regime of antagonism. And as long as you leave a room for the other, you're in the regime of agonism. So, in a way, it's every statement that decides for itself in which space it can exist.
Thank you. Next one. Yes, please.
Good morning. I just wanted to ask you about the specific time and specific place when you did a traffic exhibition. And I was wondering if there was a background of the artist who came from a sort of institutional critique, and then how contemporary art or contemporary center could sort of invite general public more into the exhibition space. And in comparison with a lot of Southeast Asian art community now, which has relatively less institutions and probably no public contemporary art museums. And so if the specific time and place in France at the time, which is already 20 years ago, had something to do with the institutional critique, or trying to sort of open up the institutions. And I was just wondering how to relate to the condition of many of the Southeast Asian now. But I just wanted to ask you the background of those time in Southern France.
Mami, there are many different regimes, I think, of institutional critique. For example, if we think about all the works made in this direction in the 1960s, for example, Dan Graham, Michael Asher, Daniel Buren, and whoever, all those artists from Europe and the United States, you know, in the 1960s, were actually taking the museum or the gallery as the symbol of something, as a metaphor for something. Which is interesting to look at is that from the 90s, you know, and the 2000s, the museum and the gallery is seen by the artist not as a symbol of something anymore, but as just part of a system, you know? And there's a totally different way to envision the museum and the gallery within the realm of the institutional critique.
And that's an interesting about this. The artists are doing more equivalences now with other types of spaces, you know, in the city, which were not existing in the 60s. So what I mean is every context generates its type of intervention or its type of critique, actually. So it's difficult to sum it up and take a very specific type of intervention in the West, you know, at a certain moment as a kind of model. It's really important to judge things within the context and to see how new approaches can appear, you know, from different spots, you know, in the world. It's not the same everywhere. That's really important to take this example to say it again.
And that's exactly what I thought. But maybe my question was, why do you think those type of practices emerged from?
Can you say it again?
Yeah, the why, the reason why.
Which night here, actually, that's a bigger problem for me.
So the reason why the those type of new practices emerged from France at the time.
Why do type of practices emerge from where? Well, I didn't, actually. No, I think that not so many French artists and the people I've actually mentioned, you know, and I think it happened somewhere else, somewhere.
So you just named it. You just gave a word for over the condition of those phenomena at the time.
Yeah, you know, yes, no, that's it. No. But I cannot identify all those things with a specific country or even a place. I was mentioning, you know, yeah, Recrit, you know, Thai, born in Argentina, Orozco, being a Mexican, you know, exiled in New York at the time, you know. I could name many artists, but I don't think there is a specific country actually linked to this. And I think that's the main location. It's more like in between. No.
Okay. No, not about the specific country, but just sort of vague idea of how and why it came out. I mean, there were a lot of similar practices in Asia too, but I was just wondering whether there was the some sort of social context that you could read. But if not, that's okay.
Well, how can I answer this? I think my only goal actually was to find the common point between artists who are actually working together, you know, in different places and organizing exhibitions by themselves, self-organizing, working together as artist curators sometimes, you know, inviting each other all the time. So I think it's strange, all those people are actually working together, trying to do things together. So what's the common point? And that's a very simple question that led me to write this book, actually. And it's super simple. You know? You take 20 people and you see that obviously there is a connection, and you try to find which is the connection. Because they didn't, you know, they actually didn't see it the same way as I did from the outside. You know? I had a different angle of view.
Isn't it somehow worrisome as well, the fact that you tend to over-generalize all these phenomena into...
No, because that's exactly my position in the in this system, in a way. You know, an artist, like whoever he or she is, doesn't necessarily have to envision a broader picture. I do. You know, that's the only element that makes me produce something different.